Today's panel is called The Future of Psychedelics, What's Next? And I have a really fantastic panel here today. I'm really excited about talk about potential future avenues for research and regulation of psychedelic drugs. As I'm sure a lot of you know, the history, the past century of psychedelic drugs has been a bit of a roller coaster ride. In the 1950s and 60s, there were tens of thousands of people who were treated in studies with LSD, psilocybin, other psychedelic drugs, and they were considered a very promising psychiatric treatment in various contexts. Unfortunately, in the 1960s and going onward, psychedelics became associated with social upheaval and with some countercultural elements, you could say. And the research into psychedelic drugs was completely shut down from about the late 1960s till only about a decade ago. And it's quite amazing to see the past decade, how little by little, more and more studies are popping back up, not just looking at the safety of psychedelics, but also looking at their efficacy being used as part of various therapy models to treat conditions such as post-traumatic stress disorder, end-of-life anxiety, substance abuse disorders, and other conditions that are very hard to treat. So our first speaker today probably needs very little introduction. He's Rick Doblin. He's the founder and executive director of the Multidisciplinary Association for Psychedelic Studies, also known as MAPS. He received his doctorate from Harvard's Kennedy School of Government, where he wrote his dissertation on the regulation of the medical uses of psychedelics and marijuana. And his professional goal is to help develop legal context for the beneficial uses of psychedelics and marijuana, primarily as prescription medicines, but also for personal growth for otherwise healthy people. So please welcome Rick Doblin.
Well, welcome everyone. But I think it's really good that they started this panel at 10 this morning instead of at 9:30. Well, what I'd like to do briefly is give you an overview of what MAPS is doing to try to move forward with research with psychedelics and marijuana, and also our other main contribution right now is developing harm reduction methods for reducing difficult experiences that people have at festivals. And partially why we're doing this mix of focus, both on the legal, regulated, scientific research, trying to make things into accepted medicines, and then also doing the harm reduction work for people that are having experiences illegally in sort of recreational celebratory settings, is that I woke up to psychedelics in 1971 and 72. I'd been sort of brainwashed in my youth by education that made me think that one dose of LSD made you permanently crazy in some deep way that you could never reverse. And so once I started realizing that I'd been fed a lot of information that was more fear-based, not really accurate, and I saw the incredible potential of psychedelics, I woke up just at the time that the backlash had really happened and shut it all down. So this whole time since, I've been very acutely sensitive to the idea that we have to proceed in a slow, gradual way, learn the lessons of the 60s, not repeat them, and then be very sensitively attuned to where other backlashes might come from. And so right now, as we're starting to make incredible progress with psychedelic research, it's even more incumbent upon us to look at the casualties, you could say, and the risks from the non-medical use of psychedelics so that we can respond to those situations and reduce the casualties and reduce the fear of parents and families about their kids. And so I think there are two interwoven parts of what we're doing. The harm reduction at festivals is what, in a way, gets us directly involved here with the Drug Policy Alliance, because harm reduction methods are really illegal in a lot of ways. And we're having to fight against the fear of promoters that they could go to jail, be arrested, have their assets taken away from them for providing harm reduction services. So I think the work on the one hand is strictly scientific to do the research, but even that is not without politics. So for that reason also, we've chosen to focus not just on psychedelic research, but also on medical marijuana research. And so surprisingly, right now, you know, there's more psychedelic research than there's been in the last 40 years. We're making progress all over the world. And at the same time, there's not one single group, not one single study anywhere in the world of which I'm aware where marijuana is being studied with the intent of having it be transformed into a legal prescription medicine in plant form. And so it's like the frontiers of the political suppression of scientific research have moved beyond psychedelics. The frontiers are medical marijuana research. And so that's why we've really focused on it for political reasons, but also because marijuana has incredible medical potential. But what we're most interested in is this idea of non-ordinary states of consciousness and how psychedelics can produce them and how a lot of healings can come from different states of consciousness. Marijuana is mostly a medicine for what it does physically, although there's more increasing interest in marijuana for PTSD in particular, and lots of people, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands probably, are using marijuana for PTSD, and it's never been studied. So when we had a meeting with FDA to discuss our marijuana PTSD study, this is 3 years ago, and at the end of it, I sort of apologized, and I said to the FDA that our main interest is MDMA-assisted psychotherapy for PTSD because that offers people the opportunity of a cure, that there are ways where people who have had PTSD for long periods of time can actually overcome it and move on. And so I'm sort of cautious about using the word cure, but I said that's really why our top priority is MDMA-assisted psychotherapy for PTSD. But on the other hand, for marijuana, a lot of people get a lot of benefits from it. It's just that it doesn't cure the situation, and they need to be using marijuana chronically most of the time, for very long periods of time. And so Dr. Tom Laughlin, who was the head of the psychiatry products for FDA, said, you don't need to apologize for just treating symptoms. In our field of mental illness, we almost never cure anything. You know, it's always just about reducing symptoms, and the pharmaceutical companies aren't coming to us with drugs that cure things. So I could imagine in the future integrated processes where we work with marijuana and MDMA for post-traumatic stress disorder. One of the ways that could possibly be is that we require people who are in our MDMA studies to withdraw from all the psychiatric medications that they're on. And that's often a difficult process. But it's because most of the psychiatric medications mute the effects of MDMA. And so we want them to have a full MDMA experience. But during this period of 6 weeks or 7 weeks, or depending on which drugs they're taking, it has to be six half-lives of the drug before they're sort of washed out. Marijuana could be used pretty effectively during that period because they only need to stop marijuana a few days before they get the MDMA. So you could imagine these combination. And then some people, once they're done with the MDMA, they might not feel perfectly cured. They might still want to use marijuana at some point. So our main focus has been since 1986, when I started MAPS, was to work primarily on MDMA. But there was two symbolic things that we needed to do, I felt, in order to really bring the psychedelic renaissance back. One was to start research at Harvard, where Timothy Leary had been. And so we needed to kind of overcome the ghost of Timothy Leary. And we were able to do that at McLean Hospital with a study with MDMA for anxiety in cancer patients with 1 year or less to live. And so by working with people at the end of life, politically it's an incredibly potent group of patients because that's all of us. We're all going to die. We all have some anxiety about it. And so it doesn't seem like it's a drug for people who want religious inspiration or are willing to take psychedelics and go through all these experiences. It's a drug for the mainstream. That's what we're trying to show. And so we were able to use that idea of people at the end of life to get Harvard finally to open up to MDMA research and to resume psychedelic research there at Harvard. Now we're discussing an MDMA obsessive compulsive disorder study as another possibility at McLean Hospital. The other big thing symbolically was that we had to start research with LSD. Because again, LSD is the quintessential symbol of the 60s. And when people hear the word psychedelic, they usually hear LSD. So we were able to do that as well in Switzerland, again, in the treatment of people who had anxiety because of end of life. And one of the things I'm most proud of, that study is now currently under review at the Journal of Nervous and Mental Disease. It looks like we've got a real good chance of getting it accepted. And it was a small study in 12 subjects. But the most important point from my perspective, from a political perspective, is that 11 out of the 12 subjects had never done LSD before. So again, it's this idea that we're bringing this out of the psychedelic 60s, trying to take the sort of revolutionary aspects out of it and more focus on their therapeutic, scientific potential. And at the same time, I think what motivates it is exactly that sort of inspiration from the 60s, that people who have had psychedelic experiences, not all of them, but many of them have had these deeply mystical sense of connection to all of life, and that that has substantial political implications in their lives. And once you can identify as part of the human family or as part of the web of life on Earth beyond just humans, that you can be more compassionate towards the other. You won't be so easily motivated to war, that you won't be so racist, you won't be so sexist, that's where I think the grounding in this deep sense, not just an intellectual sense, but an emotional sense, that's what I think is why we're motivated, a lot of us are motivated to do this. So the medical part is really important in and of itself. It has to stand or fall on its own merits, but there's a broader way of importance for doing this in terms of opening these drugs to broader uses in society. So we're now halfway, I'd say, between in phase two, which is where we're developing the methodological understandings of how to do the large-scale phase three studies that are the ones that prove safety and efficacy. So we have research published in two studies with terrific results. We have studies right now in Israel and Canada, two studies in the United States. We're working in just trying to start a study in England and Australia. So it's an international series of phase two studies, and in about 2.5 years or so, we have a meeting with FDA it's called the end of phase two meeting, where you propose your phase three designs. And then once you get agreement on that, then we price it out, then we probably have 400 patients we're anticipating. We'll probably have about 80 or 90 patients in the phase two, and then 400 in phase three. The whole thing will be about $20 million over about 8 years, which is not that far out of our reach. And so I think we'll be able to accomplish it. And then the future beyond that is, I see this as a doorway towards broader legalization. That we know from the work on medical marijuana that what has really motivated the public shift in opinion towards legalization, a lot of it has to do with medical marijuana. That people have gotten a different view of the risks and benefits of marijuana. And the most important factor that determines whether somebody has been votes for legalization of marijuana is if they know a medical marijuana patient. So I think the scientific research to medicalize makes a bigger impact as well. Now, I think the FDA is going to require a lot of particular restrictions on MDMA or psilocybin for end of life once they become medicines, because these are not medicines in and of themselves. These are tools to assist psychotherapy. And so therefore, I believe that the FDA will require the therapists, the prescribers, to have training in our therapeutic method. And they might even require it the same way that methadone began, was research and treatment is only in certain kind of clinics. So what we're talking about is, again, rolling out something in a society slowly, step by step, so that there is no backlash. And so some of the early ways may seem more restrictive than we would eventually like, but I think it makes sense to do that. So once we have prescription medicines and we have these trained therapists who can prescribe and we have these clinics or locations where they can prescribe them in, then I think we're going to be 5 years or so of treating patients, but you can also prescribe off-label. And what that means is that physicians can have their independent judgment, and they can take a drug that's approved for one thing and they can prescribe it for anything else. So people don't have to follow our method for treating PTSD. They don't have to even work with PTSD patients. But I believe there should be a national registry of patients. There should be a single pharmacy. Every prescription that's given should be, at least initially, accompanied with a diagnosis so that the sponsor gathers information on how it's being used. So there's, again, federal lists that can be problematic. There's lists of what off-label things are being prescribed, but the DEA cannot block off-label prescription. So I think once we have that system in place, then eventually, like for the work with end of life, why is it that it's only the dying person that gets the psilocybin or the MDMA or the LSD? What about their families who are going through grieving as well? So eventually I think we'll start getting family members and other people to come to these clinics who aren't specifically holding a diagnosis. And then I think the next stage of expansion is going to be where we think about psychedelics as a basic human right. They should be legal for adults, but they're dangerous. They're powerful tools, and we want to be careful so that people know what they're getting into. So I think we can move towards a system better, I think, than we have for alcohol right now, is that I think there should be a license to do drugs. And it's not necessarily that hard to get, but the thing is it can be taken away from you if you misbehave. But that it could be like driver's license, where you actually have to go to a clinic, you have your first experience, and then if you know you don't have a terrible experience, you get permission to then buy it and do it on your own, anywhere. So that's the doorway, in a way, to long-term social legalization with some education required. Just the same way that cars are dangerous as well to others if the driver is not fully trained, that psychedelics can be dangerous to people and to others if they're really not aware of what people are getting into. All right, so then the other part of this, which is kind of relatively new to us, is that once the FDA has a policy, once you get a drug into a medicine, even if it's off patent, and all the psychedelics are off patent, and there's no use patents, but once you have developed a drug into a medicine that's never been made into a medicine before, the FDA gives what's called data exclusivity for 5 years. And so what that means is that nobody can use your data to argue to have a generic drug. And since it takes more than 5 years to do the research and takes $20 million or so, it's unlikely that anybody will try to replicate the data. They could develop a new indication. So somebody could say, I want to develop MDMA for social anxiety in autistic adults. So we're actually starting that study at UCLA very soon. But they could come up with something else. So there might be competition in a way, but there's a good chance that the sponsors, Hefter for psilocybin, MAPS for MDMA, will have this 5-year period where we'll be the only ones marketing this drug. And because we're doing it in a nonprofit context, we're not trying to maximize profits, but we're trying to roll it out in a way that treats as many people as possible, but again, avoids this backlash. So what we have this ability to do, unlike most nonprofits where you have a social mission that just is endless, feeding the hungry, stuff like that, we have a social mission that ends with a product that is on the market for sale. So we're talking about building organizations like Hefter and MAPS that have the opportunity to be sustainable, so that the income from the sale of the drugs that we've made into medicines fuels further research, so we're not always constantly asking people for money. So I think the future will have this sort of private, nonprofit engines of research, other than the government, although hopefully the government will come around too. We're negotiating right now with NIMH about a support for an MDMA PTSD study. Probably takes another couple of years to see if we can even get it. We're negotiating with the VA right now and the Department of Defense, although they're still resistant, but we're working with veterans outside their systems. So eventually I think we'll see a return to government funding of this research, to major foundations, not being scared. At a meeting in England with the Wellcome Trust, they're the biggest nonprofit in England, $20 billion in assets founded by a pharmaceutical industry focused on neuroscience. And what they said was about MDMA PTSD research that it's a reputational risk for them. So I said, it's a reputational opportunity for you to get involved at an early stage. And they concluded too much that it was a risk and decided not to support anything we're doing. But I think that the future will be a broadening of research, a broadening of funding support, and changing of public consciousness about the value of these drugs and the value of different states of consciousness, and then moving towards probably in 30 years. So I want to say that and this will be the last thing I say, which is that in 1974 was the first hospice center. And now, in 2004, 30 years later, there was 3,500 of them. So I think it takes 20, 30 years to roll out a new approach into a culture. So we're anticipating more or less 2021 is our target date for MDMA becoming a prescription medicine. And then it'll be another, 10 years for these clinics and expansion, and probably 30 years from now, where every town that has a hospice center will have a psychedelic treatment center right next to it. So that's the future.
So the next speaker is Gabby Agin-Liebes. She's the project manager of the NYU Psilocybin Cancer Anxiety Project at the NYU School of Medicine and research assistant at the NYU Bluestone Center for a trial examining the effects of a cannabis-based oral spray medication on the treatment of advanced cancer pain. Gabby has a master's from the NYU Graduate School in Psychology and plans to pursue a doctorate in clinical psychology. And her research interests center on the investigation of psychedelics as a tool for personal transformation and promoting psychological and spiritual health in individuals confronted with stressful life events, chronic illness and trauma, and an integration of spirituality into clinical care. You may have also noticed that George Greer, who's listed on the program, is not here, so Gabby's also going to discuss the work more generally of the Hefter Research Center, which is, in addition to MAPS, the other major organization based in the U.S. that's supporting and promoting research with psychedelic drugs. So, Gabby, take it away.
I'm going to start off, I guess I'm George right now. look a little bit like George. My hair a little bit, should have prepared more for the presentation. But I'm very proud to give a sort of Hefter Institute update and a quick review of what we are, what Hefter is doing right now. So Hefter is a nonprofit organization. It was founded, I believe, 20, 25 years ago by a leading group of scientists. A lot of these scientists had been doing work for decades prior to the sort of renaissance, the resurgence of this work. But it remains the only neuroscience, I'm reading this from the website, but the only neuroscience institute dedicated to supporting research with psychedelic substances in order to contribute to a greater understanding of the mind, improvement of the human condition, and the alleviation of suffering. And they've done an amazing job with that endeavor. So in total, they've raised $4 million for a whole slew of projects, so I'll quickly go through them. And I will segue into some discussion of the current projects, one of which Albert will talk about, or a few actually at Hopkins. But historically, there was psilocybin, and most of this research actually has been done with psilocybin. So psilocybin was studied at the University of Arizona. Dr. Francis Moreno studied psilocybin to treat obsessive compulsive disorder. And the results were favorable. However, there a lot of researchers are looking to sort of replicate slightly modify the design to see if we can get a sort of a better effect size. Next one, this is a pretty landmark study. It's psilocybin in the treatment of depression and anxiety in terminal cancer patients. So Dr. Charlie Grove at UCLA, was the first one to bring back this paradigm. As I think it was mentioned, LSD was used for quite some time back in the 60s and 70s to treat addiction, but end-of-life distress was the second most investigated indication for psychedelics therapy. So Dr. Grobe was able to secure funding from Hefter and approvals from UCLA and did the first pilot study of treatment of depression, anxiety, and terminal cancer patients. So his was a small study. It was 12 total participants, but it sort of paved the way for research that I'm doing right now at NYU and some of the work that's being done at Hopkins, which is I will get to right now, study of psilocybin and the treatment of anxiety and depression. So Dr. Grobes was studying just anxiety at Hopkins. They're doing both anxiety and depression from a life-threatening cancer diagnosis. We're doing the same at NYU. We have a slightly different design, and I will describe that in greater depth in my presentation next. But we are sort of working in tandem and hoping to finish, kind of close our wrap up, which is probably going to happen in the next few months, recruiting and then follow up. So within the year, we're hoping to finish these studies, which are phase two, and just in with regard to FDA funding and the like sort of hopefully not far near the near future, hopefully not too far much beyond. We are hoping to get approval for psilocybin to treat anxiety and end-of-life distress, so for this very specific indication. And the next step would be a phase three trial, which would be a multi-site study. So we have to finish up our phase two analyzer data and then get to that next step. But that's a big project that is on the horizon. And then the next, we are funding, or Hefter is funding, psilocybin in the treatment of alcoholism, and I will get also into more in my presentation. So there's Dr. Michael Bogenschutz at the University of New Mexico. He has just finished his pilot study to treat psilocybin to treat alcoholism. So alcoholism was studied, or LSD was studied in the treatment of alcoholism for a very long time. One of the groups in Maryland did there was a lot of data and very promising data in a recent meta-analysis reviewed all of the data and all of the literature from that time, because not all the trials at that point were as controlled and as rigorous, scientifically rigorous as we are trying to do now. So, but it did show that there was a treatment effect, and that sort of inspired Dr. Bogenschutz to do this pilot study at New Mexico. And then we are about to begin with a partnership with New Mexico and NYU, a control trial. So Dr. Bogenschutz's study right now is open label, which means that everyone knows that they're getting psilocybin. There's no blinding. It's there are no other treatment groups. They're just trying to see if there's safety and efficacy data we can get from this. And then I'm going to wrap up quickly. I think Albert can give sort of a little rundown of all. I mean, there's just so much amazing work being done at Hopkins, psilocybin and spirituality, by Dr. Griffiths, Roland Griffiths. And meditation, they're doing a long-term meditator study. And then we have a colleague in Switzerland, Franz Vollenbeiner, who's doing a lot of, he's like our neuroimaging extraordinaire. So he's studying the effects of psilocybin on brain functions, mediating the effects of self and emotion regulation in Switzerland. And the last thing, we have Dr. Charles Nichols, who happens to be the son of Dave Nichols, who's a pretty pioneering psychopharmacologist. He's done a lot of LSD work throughout the last few decades. His son is studying molecular effects of psychedelics on gene expression in the brain, as well as their powerful anti-inflammatory properties. And that is it. So there's a lot going on. More than, the past 3 years, there's just been, Hefter's received more proposals from institutions you wouldn't expect. It's you know, you feel like that people are kind of coming out of the closet, and it's really academic centers. So it's really evolving and in really positive ways. So Hefter is, yeah, I mean, they're very committed to sort of the scientific rigor of these clinical trials. So they do a really good job sort of promoting a real integrity of research and science, and very much sort of separating ourselves from the political mess of the 60s. So now I'm going to talk about what I do, which is always fun for me. So I am, as Jag introduced to you, I am the project manager of the NYU Psilocybin Cancer project at NYU, and we are a small but maturing research group at NYU. Right now we are finishing up our cancer study, but that has been, that's our only psilocybin, current psilocybin study in the moment. But we are, you know, maturing as we go along, and as part of, as a very kind of small group within a very large, very kind of Western allopathic medical, like sort of a hospital which has this sort of Western medical model, it's been very difficult, and it's been quite challenging to feel secure doing our work there. But we are, you know, beginning to find our allies, and politically and intra-institutionally, it's becoming, you know, a little and slowly more comfortable to do our work. So we're like in the, I guess, the adolescent stage of our sort of research, sometimes child, but all in the service of work and transcendence. So anyway, I want to give you a quick sort of rundown about design of our study. So our study is double-blind, randomized. I mean, research, you have all these terms. So randomized, double-blind, controlled, crossover study. So what that means is we are recruiting patients who have cancer and have anxiety about their cancer. So distress, what we're seeing is the distress is almost always existential. And I'll get into that a little bit more. But quickly, the design, cancer patient with anxiety has to meet a certain, there's a certain whole slew of inclusion and exclusion criteria. Once they make it into the study, they receive two therapists, usually a dyad of male-female, which hews to the model that was that was done back in 60s and 70s. Stan Groff, especially, is a famous psychiatrist. He's done this, a lot of this work at Spring Grove. He kind of, a lot of our models really kind of, extends on their and their work and really utilizes their methodology. So we have one patient, two therapists, usually male-female. So these people come in, they have, you know, these anxiety, fears of death. I'll talk more about the existential stuff. But they then have three or four preparatory psychotherapy sessions to prepare them for this psilocybin experience. So everything's sort of oriented around the psilocybin experience, like supporting the psilocybin experience. However, I really want to emphasize that, especially at NYU, we are very clinically oriented, and I mean, there's a lot of tension between clinical research and clinical treatment, and clinical care. However, we, my discussion later, quick discussion, I want to talk about how translating this work into like a treatment would, in our opinion, you can't separate the therapeutic, the therapy from the psilocybin, the medication, the dose, experience, the dosing. So we spend a lot of time, you know, reviewing the narrative of these people's lives, getting to know them in a very fundamental way, and understanding their story, their cancer narrative, and understanding how the cancer trauma has changed their story, changed their, you know, provoked this crisis of meaning. And so what we notice is that, you know, you to qualify this part of the study, you can have a whole, there are a bunch of anxiety disorders you can have, but most of our patients have what we call adjustment disorder with anxiety or mixed depression and anxiety, but it's adjustment disorder is essentially it's sort of a DSM criteria that's, it's a criteria that is sort of not, if you don't fit the others, there's this one. So it's essentially, you know, distress induced by a stressful life event. So almost all these people, you know, they may have pre-existing anxiety, but the anxiety that is, you know, that they're contending with and they're coming to us with, and it's palpable, is this existential, you know, fears that they have, which involves, you know, this real fear of death. Some people, you know, have just this sort of fear of the oblivion of what's to come. They feel this loss of meaning. They feel alone in the world. They've lost connection with themselves and their relationships. So what we do is really try to support them in a cultivation of an attention. Attention's keys. And during the dosing session, we don't really do much. We kind of allow them to have an experience, but the intention to, overcome their fear of cancer, or cultivate a, you know, greater acceptance or presence in their lives, whatever that is, we are trying to support them in that experience. So it's not really the psilocybin itself that is producing the change, we think, but it's the experience. It's like an experience-induced like treatment, powerful experience. So we do preparation, and then just as important as an integration, we do a lot of integration to help process the experience. In the interest of time, I'm just gonna speed through. Just one more thing about the integration. We had a patient, a 22-year-old, who is very reductionist. He's actually, he had his dosing a week before his first week of medical school. And he had lymphoma and was diagnosed like at the end of, or in the middle of his senior year of college, and was just totally, totally gripped by this fear. But so he came to us with sort of the proper anxiety, the appropriate anxiety. But in his narrative after the study, and one more thing I want to mention, his way of coping was alcohol. He drank about, interesting, champagne. He drank like a bottle of champagne a day. I guess champagne's the new drink. But anyway, he drank, that's how he coped. And then he hadn't ever tried hallucinogens, but after his experience, he said, this drug is nothing like, you know, nothing like alcohol. This is very, very, he said, how do I describe the ineffable? This is something that you, this is real work. It's like school, he compared it to. And he's a very kind of academic person, so he said, this is like hard lesson, you need to do your homework. And so the integration is very important, because it's, you know, what comes up in the session is important, but what we find is supports the real transformation lies in the integration of what has been sort of seen and learned and worked with after that experience. So our patients, we've treated about 27 at this point. All have improved on anxiety, depression measures, some more dramatically than others, but a lot have had sort of sustaining effects. Just quickly, how much time do I have, or am I totally out of time? Okay, I'm gonna wrap up. And then I wanted to, I will tell you about some of the other work that we're doing at NYU quickly, but I do really want to emphasize the importance of one of these new projects we have just started. So we've integrated a qualitative component to our study. So it's an adjunct to the existing psilocybin study we have. But it's an interview sort of study. So after the patients have their psilocybin experience, or after they have their second dosing, oh, I forgot to mention there's two dosings, psilocybin and placebo, and then there's sort of sessions in between to integrate. But so after their second session, they have an interview, and we developed a bunch of sort of open-ended questions to ask them about their experience, because we use all these quantitative measures, which is really, essential in this type of research, quantitative research, but really doesn't capture the real sort of lived experience of what's going on with these patients. And we also, as this was sort of mentioned yesterday in one of the psychedelic panels, that we're really trying to understand. I mean, this field is not new, and if we think about the more sort of historical roots of traditional roots of this this type of ritual and work, which has used these medicines and sacraments, we're still trying to learn about how these things work, how psilocybin produces these dramatic changes. So the qualitative work is really a step in that direction, trying to not have a hypothesis. That's what you in quantitative research, you have to have a question built on research that was done prior, and so you have a question, you're proving if it's wrong or not. But with qualitative research, it's open, and we are just really trying to see patterns and try to find a narrative that might explain what is going on in these very profound experiences. And I think in terms of the next step, and that's the theme of this panel, is I really believe that the qualitative work is essential for that. In terms of even designing our studies, even the quantitative work to help us sort of elucidate what is going on. It's this phenomenon, the phenomena of the psychedelic experience is not easily classified, and it's also not easy to kind of put that into a clinical research model. So this can help us, inform us about what's going on and how to sort of design future studies. So the last thing I want to say, we are starting in about a week a ketamine for a depression trial at NYU. So this is really interesting. So ketamine, as you know, is a dissociative anesthetic. It's been used in hospitals. It's a Schedule 3 drug. So it's not Schedule 1 like psilocybin. It can be used. It's used all the time, actually, as a pain reliever, and we are looking to apply it sort of translational research to see if it can be a potentially rapidly acting antidepressant. And there's been some research in the past like 10, 15 years which kind of points to that. And then the alcoholism study, which I mentioned before, we are starting probably in the next month or so with the University of New Mexico. And studying alcoholism compared to, I can't really reveal we don't really know what the placebo will be yet, but it's going to be the first psilocybin study to treat alcoholism. There were the LSD studies, but this first controlled and, the contemporary times. So there's so much more I could talk about, but I want to know. So thank you.
Thanks, Gabby. Our next speaker is Albert Garcia Romeo. He's a postdoctoral fellow at Johns Hopkins School of Medicine, where he's currently researching the effects of psychedelic compounds in human subjects with a focus on psilocybin as a potential aid in the treatment of addiction. He received his doctorate at the Institute of Transpersonal Psychology, studying the measurement experience of self-transcendence in healthy adults. Other research interests of Albert's include clinical applications of mindfulness and altered states of consciousness, and their underlying psychobiological mechanisms. Albert, take it away.
Good morning, and thank you all for coming out here. We appreciate your interest and support, hopefully support. And there's a lot of people working right now very hard to do this research, which in a lot of ways is against the grain of the mainstream scientific research paradigm. So again, we really do appreciate people who decide to come out here and support what we're doing. So as Jack mentioned, my name is Albert Garcia Romeo. I work at the Johns Hopkins School of Medicine, and we are currently working on a number of different projects, as Gabby mentioned, many of which include the use of psilocybin, which is a naturally occurring psychedelic compound. It's found in over 200 species of mushrooms. And other work that our research team has done has focused on other psychedelic or hallucinogenic compounds such as dextromethorphan and salvia divinorum. So I do want to take a moment to acknowledge my my co-researchers, the people that I work with, who are really just an amazing group of people who do behavioral pharmacology research and also clinicians who help facilitate some of these high-dose psychedelic sessions that we do. So some of those people are Catherine McLean, who got me this job, Matt Johnson, who is my boss, Roland Griffiths, who is another one of our principal investigators and a senior researcher at Hopkins, as well as Mary Casamano and Bill Richards, who have been working on giving people psychedelic drugs in a therapeutic manner for over a decade, and with Bill Richards several decades. So they've been instrumental in teaching me how to do these high-dose sessions, which I've been doing since I came on board at Hopkins last year. And I want to talk a little bit about the work that we've been doing at Hopkins, some of the work that I've done, been involved with personally, and some of which has been done under the auspices of Dr. Griffiths and Matt Johnson and Catherine McLean and so forth. So some of our most interesting past research has really focused on the potential of psilocybin to induce what we're calling these mystical type experiences. So these are experiences that for healthy, normal individuals, these are not people who are suffering from any sort of illness or disorder, but just people who are coming in for our test experiments, they tend to have these really powerful experiences under the appropriate dose, which is about 20 to 30 milligrams per 70 kilogram body weight of psilocybin. And they often characterize these experiences as being among the top 5 or 10 most important experiences of their entire lives. And we think that's fascinating because we're bringing people into a laboratory and we're giving them this compound, which is naturally occurring in mushrooms, and they walk out and say, this is as important as the birth of my firstborn child or the death of my father. And we, what Roland often says is, you know, we're not expecting that in any way, shape, or form. So to have that come up is a really eye-opening effect of these kinds of compounds. And I know that this panel is supposed to be about the future of psychedelics, so I'm going to talk a little bit more about what we're working on now, which will be published in the future, and then what we're looking at, hoping to investigate further on ahead. So we just wrapped up another study that was looking at what is the effect of psilocybin on people who are, again, healthy, normal individuals who are interested in developing a spiritual practice. So we had 75 people come in for this, and they were in different conditions, but all of them were taught a form of contemplative meditation. It was not non-denominational, so we weren't telling them that you had to become Buddhist or Taoist or Hindu or anything like that, but we taught them a basic contemplative practice where we asked them to sit and spend time every day in meditation and working with a mantra. And in the different conditions, which were just unblinded recently, some people got an ascending dose, some people got descending doses, but the gist of this study is really to see not how can psilocybin or psychedelics help people who are sick, but how can it help people who are already healthy to have even better connection with themselves, with their higher power, whatever that might be, and with the people around them. And so that is something that our team is currently working on, because when you give 75 people psilocybin, which took quite a long time, you get reams of data. And so we're now in the process of analyzing that to see what is the outcome. And so we're not quite sure yet. Another project that we're still getting ready to wrap up right now is cancer. Just like what Gabby was talking about, they're doing at NYU, and they've recently completed a smaller study at UCLA. And what we're trying to do in that study is really to see how can psilocybin and the powerful experiences that come about as a result of psilocybin help people who are at the end of life, who have this existential distress, this anxiety about leaving everything that they love behind. And we are closing in on 44 participants, which we'll be finishing hopefully in the next year. And that will be the conclusion of another project that's been longstanding at Hopkins. And finally, I'm going to talk a little bit about a project that they actually brought me on board to finish, because it started in 2008. And because everyone's so busy there, it was really hard to get anybody to focus on it. So my job has been to come in and get this done. And what I've been doing is looking at treatment of addiction with psilocybin. And we're focusing specifically on the addiction to tobacco or nicotine products, so it's people who are heavy smokers. And I'll just briefly kind of overview that study, since it's kind of my baby right now. And we've been working with 15 individuals so far, and they have all had high dose sessions of psilocybin within the context of a cognitive behavioral therapy treatment to help them quit smoking. These are mostly older people, about 51 is our mean age, and also mostly very heavy smokers, so about a pack a day for 30 or 31 years is our average. And well, our results are much better than we expected, I have to say, because the best pharmacological treatments of smoking addiction right now are considered Chantix, which is a drug also known as varenicline, made by Pfizer. It's a drug that makes hundreds of millions of dollars a year in sales for Pfizer, and the efficacy of treatment outcomes is that most people who take Chantix go back to smoking, are not able to discontinue smoking. So their success rate is roughly 25 to 30% at 6 and 12 month follow-up with people who are doing the Chantix regimen. And what we're finding with a very small, not controlled sample, mind you, but the people that we work with, which is 15 heavy smokers, is that I just did our 12th six-month follow-up, so 12 of the 15 people have made it to their six-month follow-up, and 11 of those were not smoking and have not smoked at all since their first psilocybin session. So that's a 91.6% success rate, which is pretty much unprecedented in the literature. And right now, for the five people we've had come in for their 12-month follow-up, four of those have been abstinent the entire time since their first psilocybin session, so that's an 80% success rate. Again, really way better than anything that we expected out of the gate. So that's what I've been personally working on since I got in. Another project, which I was supposed to plug yesterday, I forgot, but I want to mention it today, is we're so blown away by our success with the psilocybin for smoking, we decided to go out and look at people who are taking different kinds of psychedelic drugs in an outside laboratory setting, so whether it be a festival or at home or a party, and who report giving up cigarette smoking or reducing their smoking after these experiences. So I have an online survey going. We have over 150 people from around the world who have already come on board to let us know that they have either quit smoking after their psychedelic experience with different kinds of hallucinogens like psilocybin, ayahuasca, LSD, or they greatly reduced it. So this is apparently a thing, and we are trying to study it a little bit more in a more systematic manner. So if you or someone you know have had such an experience, please come up and talk to me afterwards. I'd love to give you the information, because we're trying to get to about 200 people so we can wrap up that study. So that's what we've done so far, or what we've been doing or are in the process of doing. I'm just going to briefly touch on some of the things that we're looking at in the future. So as I mentioned, our smoking outcomes were so good that some of the other researchers, we happen to work at Hopkins within this complex where there's all sorts of research going on. And some of the other researchers there at the National Institute on Drug Abuse, NIDA, saw our outcomes and said, whoa, what's going on here? And we said, we don't know, but it seems to be working. And so they said, well, we have an fMRI machine next door. Would you like to use it? So next year, what we're going to be doing, or what I'm going to be doing for the next year and a half probably, is running 15 more people. We're going to do pre and post fMRI, which is going to be the first ever study.
What is fMRI?
fMRI is functional magnetic resonance imaging. So that's a way of scanning the brain in real time to see where the blood flow is going to different areas. And you do that in conjunction with different kinds of tasks. So for instance, we show people pictures of a person smoking and see how much activation or blood flow goes to the amygdala, for instance, which would be like, oh man, I really want a cigarette. And what we're kind of hypothesizing is that, and we've seen in quite a few cases that we've done already, that there's a really small withdrawal or almost no withdrawal for some people with the psilocybin. We don't know why, but we're going to be looking at basically the brain, underlying brain mechanisms with the fMRI. And that's really exciting because, as I was saying, it's the first ever functional neuroimaging study of hallucinogen-facilitated treatment of addiction. So excited to be working on that. We're also looking at what are the effects of the music that's being played during the psilocybin sessions. For a long time, they've been using a kind of standard program. We recently switched to include some other kinds of more dissonant or harmonic bass music rather than just a standard Western classical music. And so we're going to start looking at some different measures and qualitative inquiry into what are the effects of the music and how can that be really optimized in terms of making our treatment outcomes as good as they can be. Some other stuff that we're looking at is possibly a treatment of depression with psilocybin. And that's something that hopefully will be getting underway at some point in the future. But there's lots of other things that we need to really investigate. There's an interesting paper from earlier this year about rats who were given psilocybin after being traumatized and then seeing this extinction of fear response much more quickly than in normal conditions after the psilocybin, as well as what they call hippocampal neurogenesis, so growth of new brain cells in the hippocampus after administration of psilocybin. So that's an indication that psilocybin might be useful for PTSD. One of my mentors, Jim Fadiman, was looking at creative problem solving with high-functioning professional people, so that's another area that might be really interesting to research with psychedelics. And as Gabby mentioned, there are already other projects underway to look at treatment of alcoholism, and I would bet that there are some really good indications that we could look at other kinds of substance use disorders like opioid addiction and so forth using this same kind of model of psychedelic psychotherapy treatment. And we'd really love to see what the outcomes would look like in something like that. So thank you very much.
Our next speaker is Ingmar Gorman, who's a doctoral student in clinical psychology at the New School for Social Research. Ingmar has studied the therapeutic alliance in MDMA-assisted psychotherapy for PTSD. He's currently launching a protocol examining broader psychotherapy processes. He's presented at a number of psychedelic conferences, has worked at the Prague Psychiatric Center, and currently serves as research study assistant at the Sloan Kettering Institute. Take it away.
All right, thank you. I get really excited during these things and I can't sit down, so I have to like stand up. So I'm honored to be here with these wonderful speakers, and I'm super excited to geek out with you all on like my favorite topic. Most often I have to present data and go through study design, and I love that. But it's not so common that I get to go to a panel and talk about what I think the future may hold. That's a little bit more, there's a little bit more creativity there. So just to clarify a little bit or to emphasize, I am a research assistant at Sloan Kettering, but I do my research with MDMA assisted psychotherapy at the New School for Social Research. So, you know, as we've heard, current psychedelic research is having quite a bit of success. There's small studies, it's still preliminary, but there's some success. And I wanted to sort of highlight two psychiatric paradigms. One paradigm which we're all familiar with is the idea that you go to a psychiatrist and you're evaluated, you are potentially prescribed medication, you take a pill once a day, and you may see your psychiatrist every so often for reevaluation. And that's pretty much how that goes. It's very different from the paradigm that psychedelic research uses. And we've heard a little bit about this, but I really want to just emphasize it, that really most of the studies follow a design where a person goes to treatment, they get three psychotherapy sessions, often preparatory sessions. They allow for preparing the person for what will come in the drug session and further psychotherapy sessions. And that also allows for the building of the therapeutic alliance, or the relationship between the therapist and the person in the treatment. Then there's a drug session, which is sometimes accompanied by psychotherapy. Sometimes it's so the person is more guided to kind of go inward. And then there are often three integration sessions where the experience is kind of integrated. And that's cycles. So there might be two or three of those cycles. So in total, you might have something like 12 psychotherapy sessions, a few of which will be drug sessions. That's very different from the previous model that I highlighted. And the fundamental difference here is that there is a synergy, we believe, a synergy between the acute effects of the drug, the psychedelic, and the psychotherapy. They're working together in conjunction. And there's a lot of focus on what's going on in the brain and what is the mechanism of action in the drug, but there isn't so much research yet on what is the mechanism of action in the psychotherapy. How is it, if we're talking about drug-assisted psychotherapy, then what is being assisted by the drug? What is that psychotherapy? And that's the question that I love. I think it's a fascinating question. And the answer to that question has several really, really, really important implications. First of all, the obvious one is, what is it that's being done in the room that allows for the drug to have maximum benefit? How does it improve symptoms? But it also, let's see here. Well, once we learn that, we can then also sort of talk about how we can teach therapists to do the psychotherapy as best as possible. And what's really important here is the evidence. So how do we gather evidence to answer that question? Before I go further, I want to have maybe a little interactive moment here. So who here, before coming to this panel, has heard about psychedelic psychotherapy or its research? Okay, so nearly everybody, right? And how many of you have heard about the drugs that are being used in particular, whether MDMA or... Okay, great. Now, before coming to this panel, how many of you have heard or know what kind of therapy is being done? Okay, so few of you. And I think the answer to that question really is, it's kind of unknown. I mean, we definitely have, as Gabby's mentioned, expanded on the lessons that were learned in the 60s and 70s. But, you know, I think there are different ways of doing the therapy, and it hasn't really been evaluated empirically. And there's sort of a reason for that. And I'll give you a little bit of a history lesson. So, with the emergence of antidepressants in sort of the 80s, there was a crisis in psychotherapy, because if you could give somebody a pill to relieve their symptoms, then why have, you know, so-called talk therapy? So what that forced was for psychotherapy research to sort of really kind of get a little bit more rigorous. And so psychotherapists began to say, okay, well, how do we design research studies to evaluate what's going in psychotherapy and how it contributes to outcome? And so a lot of those studies were sort of drug, well, there were the psychotherapy studies, and there are some studies that look at the drug versus the psychotherapy. But if you go into the research literature and you look into, well, what is, are there studies looking at concurrent treatment? So when you're getting antidepressant and psychotherapy. But the way that they're looking at it is just that. It's sort of like they're coexisting, but there isn't really an examination of how they're interacting. there's virtually no research on that question, and that's sort of the central thing that's happening in the psychedelic psychotherapy. So I think, you know, if I pulled one of you, if I were designing a psychotherapy, psychedelic study, and I pulled any one of you and asked you to be the therapist in the study, you're all empathic people, I think you'd do a pretty good job, but most people would probably say, well, I think you really need to have a therapist in the room to really do that. And the question is, well, why? I think we agree that we want that to happen. We want a person who's trained. But we should examine what are the things about a therapist that make them facilitate this experience. And that gives a little bit of a wrench in this whole equation, which is we also know that people do these substances outside of a clinical setting with a friend, sometimes alone, and they report, you know, anecdotally, improvement. And by no means would I ever suggest that you go do this. Especially because of the black market substances that are out there. You don't know what you're going to get. It's extremely risky. So I really want to emphasize that. But it does happen. And it makes this question of exploring what's going on in the psychotherapy, I think, even more intriguing. And so I think that is the question is, what is the future of psychedelic research? And I think that's one of the things that are going to happen. And I think it's, I just love it. So the psychotherapy factors we could examine are, what is the therapist doing? What kind of therapy techniques are they using? But we can also look at patient factors. So what is it about them that allows for this healing process to occur? And also, what is the relationship? How does the relationship between the therapist and the patient allow for improvement? And I don't know how many of you here are in the mental health field, but there's something called evidence-based treatment, which is sort of a loaded term, and there's a lot of, in psychotherapy research, there's a lot of back and forth about this. And it's very sticky. But I believe that if we want to interact with the larger mainstream psychotherapy sort of community, we need to talk in terms of this language. In other words, we need to obtain evidence to exploring these psychotherapy factors. And that, I think, has important policy implications as well. So, kind of to conclude or to summarize, I'm at the New School for Social Research. I'm a clinical doctoral student. I work with a wonderful team, a large team of student researchers who I just get immense enjoyment supervising and working with them. And what we do is we observe the MDMA-assisted psychotherapy for PTSD that MAPS is leading. We watch video sessions, and we observe everything that's happening in the room. What the therapist is doing, what the patient is doing, and how they're feeling what they're reporting, and also this relationship. And what we're able to examine that in a quantitative way, not qualitative. And when we have this, although there are qualitative elements to it, and when we have that quantitative data, we can then correlate that with outcome and see what things are maybe contributing to improvement. But what we're also planning in the future is a study looking at fMRI and other psychophysiological measures and other biomeasures, which we can also plug into that in that equation, which is really, really fascinating. So, you know, on a final note, we're just a little bit away from Boulder. And Boulder has a particular significance in clinical psychology. There's something called the Boulder model. And that model is that a clinical psychologist will be trained as both a researcher and a practitioner or practicing therapist. And I think that, you know, as a clinical psychologist, I'm biased to think that we're really important. But you know, we need more clinical psychologists in psychedelic research. I think there are not that many of us. And it's because we have this unique lens to see both worlds, to understand the therapy and what might be going on there, but also to view it from a scientific empirical kind of perspective. We have fantastic, you know, neuroscientists, and we have lots of really wonderful people who want to be therapists, but I think we also need people who can do both. And I think that's also going to be an important aspect of the future. So thank you so much for listening to me. And
Mark. Our Our next speaker is Joshua Wickerham. He's the chief advisor of the Ethnobotanical Stewardship Council, which is just launched here at the Reform Conference this week. And it's a nonprofit devoted to assuring the safety and sustainability of traditional medicinal plants and bringing benefits to communities who work with them. Joshua just returned from a 45-day research trip in Peru, conducting initial stakeholder engagement as part of the Ethnobotanical Stewardship Council's Ayahuasca Dialogues. He has a very distinguished background as a policy and outreach advisor to the ICEAL Alliance, which is the Global Association of Sustainability Standards. And he works for and advises executives of leading standards like the Rainforest Alliance, the Forest Stewardship Council, Fair Trade, and other organizations like that. He's lived most of the last decade in China and has now joined us here all the way from Thailand, where he now resides. Thanks, Josh.
Thank you so much, Jag. Jag Davies has been an enthusiastic supporter of this work since we first discussed it at Psychedemia UPenn a year ago. And I'm thankful to a lot of people, Jim Fadiman, Rick Doblin, Bia Labate, some of the luminaries in the ayahuasca world, Dennis McKenna. And this is really my first time talking about this publicly. It's a conversation that's been going on for over a year now. And I have some dual challenges and some big opportunities to share. The challenge is that traditional cultures' knowledge of medicinal plants are under threat, and that we don't have a lot of time to deal with this. And another challenge is this is a very tricky topic, and I don't want to geek out on you, because I geek out on this standards topic too. And I want to get it across in a way that makes sense. And people can come up to me afterward and geek out if they want to. And I want to talk about the opportunities that we have for improving cross-cultural dialogue, for improving the sustainability and safety of traditional plants and the people who use them, improving the environment, improving lives. I want to talk also about different ways that people see the world. And I'm sorry if you can't see the PowerPoint presentation, but I grew up in the forests of the Midwest, you know, in close relation with plants, and I was very comfortable there. But for the last 15 years, I've been traveling around the world, living a fairly urban lifestyle, and I know now enough of the game to know how it works. I mean, it's a long time coming from my initial upbringing of a mile away from the biggest town of 150 people. But as one travels, one sees that the world is quite small, and that cultures are, one can understand different cultures, and there are ways of working with different cultures and empowering them. And I've been working, researching different models of how to empower communities, how to empower ourselves, preserve individual liberties, etc. And there are other, so when people talk about sustainability, they often have this sort of model of the world, like, oh, there's some birds, and there's some trees, and there's some windmills, and we're all living a nice, urban, clean existence. But the world is much messier than that, and a biodiverse world does not really look like that picture. And from the perspective of maybe the rest of the species on the planet or the planet itself, it's, you know, what are people doing, and why are people not doing more to save the planet? Now, in the last 6 or 7 years that I've been working with the major sustainability standards, international voluntary sustainability standards like Fair Trade and Organic and the Forest Stewardship Council, I've come to see the world sort of like this. This is a map of all the forests that are certified by the Forest Stewardship Council. It's about 15% of the world's forests. So when you can live an urban existence and buy a Forest Stewardship Council certified product, and you know that the people who cut the wood have enough money to send their kids to school, biodiversity is preserved, their societies are better intact. And this is a multi-stakeholder governance system. FSC is sort of like the UN of the forest world. Or another standard is like the Marine Stewardship Council. They certify close to 20% of the world's fresh caught fish. Or probably recognize this symbol, the Fair Trade logo. So when you buy a Fair Trade product, you know that the people who made the food, or grew the food, or made the product have enough money to send their kids to school. They have basic health care. They're improving their lives. And when you look at these systems, you can begin to see the world in this way. kind of like a partnership model where we're all working hand in hand. But when we're looking at traditional models or like globalization as it is right now, these markets obscure safety hazards when it comes to traditional medicines, especially ayahuasca, and they mask unsustainable practices. So when you buy a product and you don't know how it was made, you don't know how it's impacting the rest of the planet. So as Jack noted, I've been working with these major sustainability standards and advising them over the years, mostly on China. And when I talk about sustainability standards, I usually give a talk in Mandarin. And I ask them, so what do you think about iboga, which is a root grown in Gabon and other parts of Africa that's under threat? Or what do you think about peyote in Mexico, which is also under threat? Or what do you think about ayahuasca? And the Brazilian leader of one of these standards said, I don't think we're going to do anything on ayahuasca. And some of the other standards said, well, what is ayahuasca? And so for you, those of you wondering what ayahuasca is, it's a traditional medicinal plant preparation from the Amazon. It's a vine. It's a picture of the vine. It's been used for hundreds, if not thousands, of years. And it's usually taken at night in a ceremonial context. And so I was hearing things in the community about what Mark Kleiman might call failures of voluntary action, where ayahuasca is legal in Peru. It's enshrined as intangible national heritage. It's protected by law. But visitors are going to Peru, and there's so little regulation that there are all sorts of problems popping up. People's trust has been violated. Their bodies have been violated. And there's very little differentiation of sustainable practices from unsustainable practices. So I used some of my frequent flyer miles and went to Peru for 45 days in July and August, looking at sites from the peaks of the Andes down to the teeming swamps of the Amazon. And I discovered that these sites are not that hard to get to. People have said, well, how can you do certification of these sites? They're hours away. You do have to get in boats. Sometimes the moto taxis tip over and you get covered in mud. But the best of these sites, I discovered, are like beacons of consciousness, higher consciousness in the Amazon. They're bulwarks against unsustainable development, against mining, against oil exploitation, against deforestation. And I went to places where, like this reforestation project, where they're planting millions of ayahuasca vines. And the tradition of ayahuasca use had all but died out in this community. And now they're building a ceremonial maloca. They're beginning to welcome tourists. And they're doing it in a sustainable way. On the bottom left, there's a picture of some plants growing at a permaculture site in the Amazon. And the Amazon, before it was colonized first by the Incas and then by the Spanish, was home to millions of people living in harmony with the forest, growing crops in mound gardens, and living sustainably. And you're seeing these permaculture projects pop up, and you talk to the farmers, and they're changing their practices too. They're no longer slashing and burning. They're rejuvenating the soil. So it's really exciting. But there's, you know, there's good practices, and then there, you know, there's a whole range of practices. So I came away from this feeling even more confident that I can apply and work with the community to apply some of the learning of the sustainability standards community to what's happening with ayahuasca. So it's with great pleasure that we announced today the formation of the Ethnobotanical Stewardship Council. And our vision is a world where people have safe access to traditional plant materials and knowledge, while knowing that the use of these plants is helping to protect the planet and improve people's lives. And our strategy and our theory of change is that we believe that the best way to encourage people to work safely and sustainably with traditional plants is for their good work to be recognized and rewarded. And we're working with ICERs in Europe, MAPS in the United States, PRISM in Australia, as they're kind of our incubators, and they're also our fiscal sponsors, so people can make tax-deductible donations and to these organizations while we're forming our own nonprofit entity. We have an amazing website up where people can make donations, they can suggest sites that we should investigate, good practices, bad practices. And our flagship project is the Ayahuasca Dialogues, because there's so much happening. There are tens of, or hundreds of thousands of tourists going to the Amazon, to Peru, Colombia, Ecuador, Brazil, taking ayahuasca. And so there's a great chance to improve the sustainability and safety of ayahuasca, and then apply this model to other traditional plants. And we're using a multi-stakeholder approach to set consensus, build consensus on what safety and sustainability means. And a multi-stakeholder approach means anyone who could be impacted by this consensus, or could impact it, is proactively reached out to. We would reach out to farmers, experts, government officials, indigenous, retailers, so they can all feed in. And this is a multi-year process, but for the time being, anyway, at the end of this process, what we hope to have is three main areas where the ESC can assure users of the standard. The first is the sustainable cultivation of traditional plants. The second is safe practices around their use. With regards to ayahuasca, this is basic first aid and emergency preparedness. It's knowing that you're not going to be violated by the shaman. It's knowing that you're getting the medicine that they say they're giving to you. The third area is around the sustainability of the centers themselves, applying ecotourism concepts, to know that when you visit the center, the money you spend, the presence that you have, is having a net positive impact on the ecology and the people. And we aim to recognize this good behavior through two claims. One is an on-product claim, so if you buy ayahuasca or you buy a traditional plant, you would see the ESC logo on it. And the second claim is a site claim. So if you went to an ayahuasca retreat center, you would see a star rating. And I'm not going to go into the details of this, but we want the star rating to be both accessible and rigorous. So no one should be excluded if they are in alignment with the principles and the consensus that we developed through the ayahuasca dialogues. But reaching a 5-star level should be hard. Having a 1-star rating where you're safe and you have basic sustainability thinking in mind should be fairly easy, but rigorous. So the effect should be a differentiation of the market, so you can know which sites are safe and sustainable. For the next 2 months, we're doing a crowdsourcing campaign to do our first 6-month study on ayahuasca. 60% of the budget will be mapping and engaging with stakeholders in Peru, Ecuador, Colombia, and Brazil, and hiring local researchers, having overall research management of the project. Administration of the ESC is less than 15%, which is good for a nonprofit. It's keeping the books. Trust me, when Rick Doblin appoints a fiscal manager to look over your books, you're going to do it in an accountable, responsible way. Spend the money the way you say you're going to. We're spending 10% of the money on the website and communications, social media, updating people. And then 15% of this crowdsourcing budget will be put to launching a report, a professional report at a major conference that we can use to reach out to environmental organizations, political organizations, to really get bigger funding to expand the ESC. Make the case that this can be done and should be done. And we have a goal of raising $118,000, and we're already halfway there. So we have ambitious goals, but I think they're reachable. So please tell your friends about this and visit our website and put it on your taxes. So in conclusion, I want to say that the future of psychedelics, future of traditional plants, I think is going to be more transparent, more safe, more sustainable, and it'll have a knock-on effects, positive sustainability impacts. And it's a pleasure. Thank you so much.